Welcome. I knew your name.
What do you want?
I was just saying if you knew your name.
Good morning, church family. How y'all doing? Yeah. All right, y'all, please rise for worship.
Sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. Sweet to love about you. Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one. You are the love that frees us. You are the light that leads us. Like a fire burning, Son of God, you are the one. You are the one. We're living for.
So glad to have you at First Christian Venice. Hello, everyone online. Let's say hello online. Hello. We miss you. So great to be here. Want to make you aware, one of the great things we have is our Connect card. If you come by and see me, if this is your first time here, this will be part of your welcome packet. And it's just a great way to find out information from the church. We try and keep our announcements super short, just like me, so that you don't go on and on. You can fill this out. You can put it in the receptacles or come by and see me at the Welcome Center. I would love to see you. So it's just wonderful to have you all here. I'm a happy mama. I got my little baby behind me. She's back. Freddie Fletcher. All right, everyone. We're going to do something we haven't done in a long time. Are you excited? I'm excited. Let's stand and let's greet each other. All right, everybody, we're going to start praising again. Let's hear our band.
There's a grace when the heart is undefiled. Under the way when the walls are closing in. And when I look at the space between where I used to be and the reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the standing next to me. There was another in the waters, holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden where another died for me. There is another in the fire.
Joy cannot be found. this song 1,000 hallelujahs, and we know that it is our job to praise 1,000 more times than we could even do it. It's our job. We praise an amazing God.
To sing of all you. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Good morning, church. My name's Robert, and I'm one of the elders here at First Christian Church, and I'm in the doghouse because you had to wait for me this morning. I'm chitty-chatty-chatty-daddy here in the back, so I apologize. Billy, I'm sorry. I don't want to be kicked off this team because we are blessed to have a great worship team here at First Christian Church. You know, we've been on this journey the last 9 weeks. We as a church, Mitch has been preaching on this thing called Rooted. And there's been quite a few of us in the church that have been participating in a 9-week study. And we started out with different things that are called seven rhythms to keep us closer to Christ. You know, one was like a daily devotion, and then spend time in prayer, admitting our strongholds, what kind of holds us back from our relationship with Christ. And then also serving in the community. A lot of our rooted groups have gone out and had service projects. And then sharing our story. We all have a story to share about our walk with Christ. And this morning, we're looking at sacrificial generosity, or the Sermon on the Mount. No, it's really. You know, we as a country and as a city and as a nation, we are blessed. There's so many people in this world that are so less fortunate than us. You know, we think of our brothers and sisters in Ukraine, and we can go on and on that live in poverty, but we are blessed here in the States. And granted, there are some people that have more monies than others, but yet we are still very blessed. And I know for Julia and I, we think about that the monies that we're blessed with aren't ours. God is just letting us manage it for a while. And we try really hard to be good stewards of that. And I want to thank you as a church. I think we do that well. And hopefully our minds and our ears are open to the message this morning, how we can really be tuned into that. But I get excited about Sunday morning because I get to see all of you. That's the reason I'm in the back talking too much and cause worship to be late. But the reason I get excited about Sunday morning is a chance for me to be with our church family. And the most important thing that we get to do is that we get to share communion together. And I don't know about you, I get busy in my workaday world. I'm busy doing everything, and I forget about what it's all about. The reason we're here this morning, and that's to remember our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and what he did for us. He was a sinless man, but yet he came down and he died for you and I. So I ask that you take a little time and prepare our communion cups. I ask those that are with us online that you grab some elements as far as a cracker or a juice. We want to join together in communion as a family. So let's just take some time and prepare our hearts and minds for this. Our communion verse this morning is taken from Matthew 26, verses 26 through 29. While they were eating, Jesus was in an upper room with his friends, his family, and he took bread. And he gave it to them and gave thanks. He broke it. And he said to his disciples, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took a cup, just a plain cup, that was sitting there at their dinner table. He took the cup, he gave thanks. And he gave it to his disciples, said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins." He said, "I tell you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until a day I drink it anew with my Father." Again, we are blessed as a church, and as a member of our elder leadership team, I would like to say thank you for your generosity. As you know, we're changing. We're moving. Our numbers are up, and it's exciting to see where our church is going. But thanks to you and your generosity, we're able to do a lot of things and a lot of things to come. And I thank you for that. The elder team doesn't take the decisions that we make about your monies lightly. We talk about it, we pray about it, so that we can better serve our community. And it's through your help. So I thank you for that. Will you please join with me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you that we can meet in your house, that we can come and worship along with our worship team and give you glory and honor which you deserve. Father, we pray that you will open our minds and our ears to the message this morning that Pastor Mitch has to share with us, that we can realize the blessings that we have are not ours. You're just letting us borrow it for a while. And it's our job to be good stewards of the blessings that we have. Father, I thank you for the talents and the abilities that this church has and their generosity through their monies and their talents. Father, I pray that as we unite as a church in communion, it gives us strength so that we can go out these four walls and be Christ-like to those in our community and in our world and in our family. Father, we pray that you will unite us as we pray a prayer that you taught us. As a church family, will you please join with me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Let's please rise. Water you turned into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God, amen. Into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you, yeah. 'Cause our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome the power of our God. Our God, yeah. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against?
greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, yeah, come on. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power.
There are 10 million millionaires in the world. 5 million of them live in the United States. At least 80% of humanity lives on less than $10 a day. And the rest of us find ourselves somewhere in the middle. And people routinely list money issues as a primary concern and a massive stress inducer in their lives. We're skeptical about organizations that ask for our money. We're nervous about not being able to have stuff when we really want it. And we believe wholeheartedly in allowing ourselves and our kids to live like everyone else. But here's the latest on everyone else. The most conservative estimates regarding the average credit card debt per household is, this is not including car loans and school loans, $14,743. And in all the 609.8 million credit cards held by U.S. consumers, the total U.S. consumer debt is $2.43 trillion. It doesn't take long for us to begin wondering about whether we own our stuff or our stuff, or more accurately, our creditors own us. Eventually, we come to the conclusion that money isn't a money issue. It's a heart issue. Suddenly, we find ourselves in a situation in which our lives are owned by a credit card company. All of our stuff, all those things filling our garage, begin to cause in us a kind of captivity we never imagined. We want to get a handle on our financial situation and create a legacy for our own kids so they avoid some of our same pitfalls. But that's just us, right? Our assumption is that people who have a lot of money don't really worry all that much about it. But even the wealthiest among us worry about money. Forbes recently published that over 60% of people whose worth is valued at over $5 million worry about money, particularly about teaching their kids how to manage it. It would be safe to say that people are concerned about managing their money in the present and securing their financial legacy for the future. For all of us, we'll need to learn the timeless, Bible-based notion of honoring God first with all that we have, becoming the generous people we'd hoped to become, and that somewhere in the redirection of our hearts, we'll find the freedom we'd hoped. For some of us, we'll want to know how to manage our wealth, providing for our families, and learning how to join God in His work now. So, what do we do?
All right. Good morning. Good morning. Welcome. I'm so glad that you guys are here today, and it's going to be an awesome, awesome day in the Lord's house. Thanks for watching online. We want to welcome all you guys watching online as well. You know, we started this series about 8 weeks ago, 9 weeks ago, something like that. And I came over here and I planted a seed in what I said was supernatural soil, you know, and it was just a simple seed. And it's amazing what has happened. And you know, if those of you who were last week, it was a different plant clear up to here, and then came in this week, and this is a money tree. That's what this is, a money tree. Don't you wish we could really have a money tree where money, you know, just grew on trees? But, man, it's not one of my favorite topics to talk about in the church. Honestly, it's really not, because one of the top reasons that people say they don't go to church is, well, they are just only want my money, you know? And I just want to ask you, do you really think that we want your money here at First Christian Church of Venice? Yes. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. But as we study the scripture today, we're going to see that it's not for the reason why many people who go to church think, and it's for a vastly different reason than what the world thinks. And so I want to just tell you, first of all, the reasons that we're not here today, the reasons we're not here, one of the reasons we're not here because God needs our money. Isaiah 66 says, "The earth is my footstool," God says. I mean, what could you possibly give me or make for me, you know, that's more than what I've created with the earth? The earth is my footstool. He's doing fine. God's 401k has not taken a hit. He's not worried about gas prices going up. He's not worried about inflation. There haven't been any unexpected expenses for him, you know, so that's what we're not here because God needs our money. He doesn't. And I'm not here to try to get you to give more money to the church. We're actually doing really well. We're paying all of our bills at the church. We're actually doing really, really well. We have people going out serving in the community. I mean, it's just been amazing. Last week and week before that or so, we have about 10, 11 different groups going out and serving all in the community. Just been amazing. But I'm not here. This is honestly, listen, I am not here to try to get you to give more money. There's not some kind of secret manipulative thing to get you to give more money. But the reason that I am talking about this, it's a part of Rooted for one thing, but the reason I am talking about this is because when we get the generosity part right, when we learn the generosity part, it actually increases our faith. When we get the generosity part right, it actually increases our trust in our Heavenly Father. And when we get the generosity part, it actually gives us a higher capacity to love our neighbors and to love our community and love those around us. So based on Scripture, if I were just to look at Scripture, based on Scripture and based on our current cultural challenges that we have, if I was a betting man and Jesus was coming here to talk to us today, I believe with all my heart that one of the top topics that he would talk about is actually money. And if we read just the Gospels alone, even if we read the Gospels, you'll see that Jesus constantly shows up inside of culture. When Jesus came, he shows up inside of culture, and what he wants to do is he wants to put the kingdom of God on display. And so he would always meet people where they are, and he would meet them with what they're struggling with and give them solutions with practical needs. And in most cases, he would provide for people's physical need before he would address even a spiritual issue or a spiritual problem in their life. And he would ultimately address people. He would address the people about the things that are distracting them from God, the things that are pulling them away from God. And he had the ability, Jesus had the ability to look and see what is the war that we are waging inside of our heart that's keeping us from serving God with the fullest capacity that we have. And I say this often, that money is the number one contender for our hearts. It really is. And one of the top cultural challenges that Jesus talks about is money. He talks about that a lot, actually, money. Because everywhere we go, everything we see in our culture now is all about what you drive, what you wear, how you smell. Some of you smell, you know, and how what you eat and what you drink. That kind of says who we are, right? And the reason that we're doing this as a part of the Rooted series is because generosity, sacrificial generosity, is one of the seven healthy rhythms in our lives. Because we don't want our hearts to be distracted. I've said this before, that you know that there's about 500 verses on faith, there's about 500 verses on prayer, and there's over 2,000 verses on money. Because God knows, money's a number one contender for our hearts. And it's not just in Venice, Florida. I mean, we're blessed in Venice, right? I mean, we're really blessed. This is an amazing place to live. I absolutely love it. Absolutely love it. Love it. Love it here. I've been here for, what, a year and a half now? Something like that. Not even quite that. And it is amazing. But it's not just Venice that struggles with this. It's not just the United States that struggles with this. They culturally struggled with this issue in the first century church and even when Jesus was walking and talking with his disciples. Now, money is not bad. Money in itself is not bad. I mean, we need money to make the world go around, right? I mean, but the problem that Jesus lays out for us is the love of money. The drive just to make more money because we love more money. How many times have I said this? And how many times have you said this? And be honest with yourself. You said, I wish I had more money to be more generous. Boy, if I had that kind of money like that person, I'd be so generous. I caught myself saying this the other day, and I was like, ah, geez, I got to speak on this, and I just said what I was saying. I got in the car and a buddy was getting in the car. I said, I'd make a pretty good rich guy, you know. I'd be a good rich man because I'd be helping so many people. I said that. I actually said that more than once. And I think as Christ followers, all of us want to be more free. We want to be more generous. We want to help more people. And yet sometimes we think, if I only just had a little bit more money, I'd be able to help more people. Right? We've said that. We thought that. But here's the reality. And I'm saying this. I'm stepping on my toes. I'm preaching this just as much to me as I am to you, okay? The reality is that for so many people, what they currently have now is never enough for them to demonstrate the level of generosity that they wish they could. I'm going to say it again just because it's hard to kind of grasp that. The reality is that for so many people, what they currently have now is never enough for them to demonstrate the level of generosity that they wish they could. Well, Jesus talks about this, and he tells it in the form of a story. And I love this because, you know, Jesus tells stories. I'm a storyteller because I want to be like Jesus. So I tell stories. You guys know I love stories. And so this is what Jesus says in this story. Because people can remember stories, right? You know, you can't always remember everything, but you remember stories. Some of you guys remember some of the stories, but hopefully these stories you're going to really remember because Jesus is making a heavenly meaning out of this. And he says this. He says, again, the kingdom of heaven can be illustrated by the story of a man going on a long trip, Jesus says. Now, the man is representing God here in this case, okay? So God is the man that's going on the long trip. And this man who's going on the long trip, he calls his servants together. Who are the servants? The servants are us. So the servants are representative, you and I. So this man's going on a long trip, and he called his servants together, and he entrusted his money to them while he was gone. He gave, actually, all the money, it seems like, that he had. He gave 5 bags of silver to one, 2 bags of silver to another, and 1 bag of silver to the last, dividing it in proportion to their abilities. And then he left on his trip. The servant who received the 5 bags of silver began to invest the money and earned 5 more. The servant with the 2 bags of silver also went to work and earned 2 more. But the servant who received the 1 bag of silver dug a hole in the ground and hid the master's money. After a long time, their master returned from his trip and called them to give an account of how he had used their money, used his money. The servant to whom he had entrusted the 5 bags of silver came forward with 5 more and said, "Master, you gave me 5 bags of silver to invest, and I have earned 5 more." It says the master was full of praise. "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount." Remember that, church? Remember that? This small amount. "So now I will give you many more responsibilities." Let's celebrate that together. The servant who had received the 2 bags of silver came forward and said, "Master, you gave me 2 bags of silver to invest, and I have earned 2 more." The master said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount." Remember that? Small amount. "So now I will give you many more responsibilities. Let's celebrate together." And then it kind of takes a turn for the worse here. Then the servant with the 1 bag of silver came and said, "Master, I knew you were a harsh man, harvesting crops you didn't plant, gathering crops you didn't cultivate. I was afraid I would lose your money, so I hid it in the earth. Look, here is your money back." But the master replied, "You wicked and lazy servant, if you knew I harvested crops I didn't plant and gathered crops I didn't cultivate, why didn't you deposit my money in the bank?" They probably had banks that earned interest back then. And at least I would have gotten some interest on it, you know. And then it said, and then he ordered, "Take the money from this servant and give it to the one with the 10 bags of silver. To those who use well what they are given, even more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who do nothing, even what little they have will be taken away." Now it really turns bad. "Now throw this useless servant into outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth," you know. Yeah, Jesus didn't mince any words with his story there. All right, so the man on the journey was God, and the servant is us, right? Whose wealth are we dealing with here? God's. Who's the owner of all the wealth? God. But who did he entrust to manage it properly? Us. So we come down to this thought here, is that God is the owner and we are the managers. God is the owner, we are the managers. If you hear nothing else today, if you go away with nothing else today, go away with this. God is the owner of it all. we are the managers. This is critical for us because if we don't get the ownership piece right, we will not be able to ever find our way on this journey to generosity, to greater generosity. And we have to understand everything. I mean, when we say everything, that means everything is His. God owns everything. If there's one thing to take from this passage, is that God is the owner, we are the managers. I've been to Epcot a lot. I haven't been in a couple, 2 or 3 years before COVID. I think it's been about 3 years since I've been to Epcot. We used to go to Epcot all the time. And I love Epcot, one of the areas where there's the land and then there's the sea. I don't know if this is still there with all the remodeling they're doing, but they get to the sea and there are these birds that are out front. There's these automatronic birds that are out front. And I don't know what cartoon it comes off of. You guys might know, maybe Little Mermaid or something, but these birds are out there. What is it? Finding Nemo. Okay. And so they're finding Nemo and these birds are out there and they're going, mine, 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 mine. Have you heard that? You know, mine, mine. I think I imitate that pretty well, you guys. And that's kind of the way our culture is. You know, they're mine, mine, mine. And we're really, what we need to get to is that this is really his. It's all his. And if we can just get this one thought right about God being the owner, we will develop a greater capacity within us to have a heart of generosity towards the kingdom of God and towards others. Now, sometimes we think, and this is kind of wrong thinking, and I've been a part of this wrong thinking. Sometimes we think that 90% of the money is ours, right? 90% of the money is ours, and we owe 10% to God. And if you look at largely a lot of the Old Testament, you could get that kind of conclusion. You could kind of think that. And sometimes we just think that we own the 90% and we owe God the 10%. But this is actually not the right way to think. This is actually a legalistic Old Testament approach is what it is. Because the idea that Jesus talks about in the New Testament is that 100% of everything that we have is God's. And we get to invest it all for His kingdom. And what does that mean? That means everything. Our car, our houses, our businesses, our jobs, our family, our income, you know, our tools. I mean, I don't like to loan my tools out, but, you know, and our influence, everything that we have is to be used for the glory of God. Everything that we own, that God gives us that responsibility. This goes way beyond money. This is who we are, that God gave us this. Everything that we have, everything to use for His glory. There were three guys that were talking about tithing to the church and giving to God. And the one guy says, well, this is what I do. He says, I draw a big circle on the ground, and then I take all my money, and I just throw it up in the air. And whatever lands inside the circle, I give to God, and whatever lands outside the circle, I keep for myself. And the second guy says, well, I do something similar to that too. He says, I draw a big circle in the ground. I take all my money. I throw it up in the air, and whatever lands inside the circle is what I keep, and then whatever lands outside the circle is what I give to God. And the third guy says, well, I sort of do something similar. He says, I don't draw any circle. I just take all my money, and I throw it up in the air, and I figure whatever God wants to keep, He can have, and then I take the rest of it, you know. Anyway, that's why I don't tell a lot of jokes. I just use self-deprecating humor, you know. But I've honestly contributed to wrong thinking and wrong teaching over the years. Maybe for the first 15 years of ministry, I probably taught this concept wrong in the church. And I was just kind of repeating what I heard when I was growing up with offering time, you know. Now we come to the time of offering. This is a time to give back a small portion of what God has given to us. Dear Heavenly Father, take this token of appreciation, you know, and multiply it like you did the fish and the loaves, you know. And I would make a statement like that. Maybe you've heard somebody lead offering time like that before, you know. But we need to intentionally break that mentality. I need to intentionally break that mentality as a church. And I need to understand, and we need to understand that everything that we have is God's. And He has given us the privilege. I mean, it's a privilege when you think about this. The Creator of the universe has asked us to partner with Him in the kingdom of God, and He gives us these resources and responsibility, which is huge. and a little bit scary to manage his resources well. Psalm 24 says, "The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. The world and all its people belong to him." I've heard this question a lot over the years as a pastor. It says, people will ask me, "Hey, should I tithe on the net or should I tithe on the gross?" Anybody ever ask that? You know, I always just say, "What, do you want a net blessing or do you want a gross blessing?" You know, but when we get, I don't think it works that way. But when we view God as the owner, we will live a life way more content with what we have. Listen, there's no sin at all. In fact, that's what Jesus is saying. Invest wisely. There's no sin in trying to be the best investor of the money that we have. Not at all. In fact, it's a biblical thing to be a wise investor of our money. And if we can make more money by investing it properly, working hard, being smart, man, that's great. We should. We absolutely should. As long as our drive is not to just make more money, which is the love of money, in order to buy more happiness, which is the meaningless things, you know. But if our drive is to make more and invest well so that we can use it for the kingdom of God, that's actually a biblical concept. The problem is often we think that what we have is never enough to satisfy us. That's the problem. That becomes where that we have the love of money. And many of us live this lie of scarcity, that what we have is never enough. And so we end up kind of hoarding what we have. And when we view God as the owner, we get to see what money is to God. And that's where he says this. I'll say that I want to read this passage again in verse 21. It says, "The master was full of praise. He says, 'Well done, my good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in handling this small amount. So now I will give you many more responsibilities.'" Let's celebrate this together. Many theologians think when they look at this story of Jesus and they kind of go back through and what the money system and currency system that they used during that day when Jesus is telling this story, that one bag of silver was actually equal to 20 years of income. Imagine that. And 5 bags of silver was actually equal to 100 years of income. And yet God says this small amount. It's almost like God saying, "This is just chump change. You know, I created the universe. I created the earth. This is just chump change. I don't know how about you, but if somebody gave me and said, 'I'm going to give you 20 years worth of income,' that would change my entire life." I mean, that would change my entire life. And I guess that for many of you, it would change your life too. Having more zeros in front of a number doesn't mean anything to God. It doesn't mean anything to him. But this guy's faithful with his 5 bags of silver, and his 5 bags are doubled, and it becomes 10 bags. So when I look at this passage of Scripture, and he is saying that God is saying, "I'm giving you all of this. And if you manage my possessions well, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to bless your socks off." That's my translation. Because this is all of mine. And it seems like God doubled up this man's blessing. I'm reminded of a time. I was probably about an 8-year-old boy. And I was my grandparents lived in Georgetown, Kentucky. I always try to work a Kentucky into every single message, if you guys notice that. Sometimes I forget, but every week I try to get that, you know, stayed in there somewhere. And I was going to visit my grandparents, and about 8 years old, and they lived on a farm in the middle of nowhere in Georgetown area. And my mom and dad gave me a $10 bill, and they said, "Here, take this $10, and if you need money for candy or, you know, if you're going out for a pizza or something, you know, can help pay for that or whatever." And so I took this $10 with me and stuck it in my pocket. My grandparents took me to church. It's this little tiny country Methodist church. I love, love, love this church. And they took me to the church. And I don't remember exactly what happened, but somehow or another, the pastor was talking about giving to the Lord and talking about money. And so when the offering plate came around, I just quietly reached into my pocket. I didn't even think anybody saw. And I put my $10 in the offering plate, you know. And I didn't think anybody saw me. Next, I went home with my grandparents, spent the night. The next day, my grandmother comes out from the mailbox. Doesn't even have a postage stamp on it, but it's addressed to Mitch, you know. And there's an envelope in there. I open it up, and it's a $20 bill. And I'm like, whoa. If I give $10 to God, I get $20 back. This is an incredible deal. Now, I think what happened is my grandparents probably saw me put the money in, and they wanted to teach me a spiritual lesson there. Now, what I want to say is, I don't think it happens that way. This is not a health, wealth, prosperity message. If you guys will just give $1,000 each today, God's going to put $2,000 in your mailbox tomorrow. I don't think it's going to happen that way. I mean, it might, you know, and if you want to try it out, I'm all game for that, you know. But I don't think that it works that way. But I do think, though, I do know this, that the blessings from God through our generosity and because our generosity are much more important than adding to our financial portfolio. The blessings that we get from God through our generosity, when we live a life of generosity, we develop a greater trust in God that He's going to provide for us, that He's going to take care of our physical needs in spite of our sacrificial generosity. We're going to experience more grace. We're going to experience more love with people. We're going to experience greater joy. We're going to experience more strength, more fullness of living this Christian walk out. We're going to have more courage. And when we develop a heart of sacrificial generosity, God says, I'm going to overwhelm you. I'm going to overwhelm you with my presence. I'm going to overwhelm you with my blessings. I'm going to bless you with that which is way more valuable than money. And generosity is getting this right, that God is the owner and we are the managers. Remember that today. Before we go today, I want to introduce you to a very special friend of mine. He's been a partner in ministry with me for 22 years. And Christian Financial Resources. Darren Key is the president and CEO of Christian Financial Resources. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that. But it is the single most strategic partner that I've ever had in ministry over the years in growing and building dynamic churches and helping be the best managers of the resources that God has given us as a church and us as individuals and families. So I'm going to introduce Darren. I want to interview him a little bit here just for a few minutes. But before he comes, we take a look at this video.
Every one of us is on a quest. Our quest is to live our lives in a way that we will one day hear the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Our challenge is to use what God has entrusted to us, our time, our talent, and our treasure, to accomplish His purposes. How can you do that? By investing in church and ministry projects that change lives. By giving wisely and creating a family legacy of generosity. By being faithful, whether you have little or much. At Christian Financial Resources, we believe God owns everything. And our task as Christians is to manage everything for God. Let's face the challenge together.
All right, would you guys welcome Darren Key this morning? Thank you, Darren. Man, I'm so glad you're here today. It's great when I get to introduce my friends to my new friends and old friend like you.
And you're so much happier today. Last night, you know, I had to console him. We were watching the University of Kentucky lose. And so he was very sad, but you're happier today, so that's good.
Yeah, I'm over. I'm ready for the big tournament now. So, yeah, that was bad. But I don't think they really are. This is a football group or something. I don't know what they have the wrong shape football around here. But anyway, hey, so Darren just finished a new book called The Quest, and I just read it, and it is fantastic. It's filled with lots of stories, which, you know, I love storytelling. It's very easy to understand. It's very easy to, you know, relate to. The only thing I would say is for somebody like me, it'd be nice if you had a lot more pictures in there or something, you know. But in your book, Darren, I read this book, and I thought this really goes along well. What CFR's doing really goes along with the Rooted and the money. And in chapter one, you reference an article by Forbes magazine that talks about, like, that only 29% of people consider themselves financially healthy. And you say in your book that means 7 out of 10 Americans have more money going out than coming in, too much debt, too few investments, you know, lack of savings, and just a heavy load of stress when it comes to finances. And I don't know that we fall in that category of 7 out of 10 here, but I'm sure there's still some of us that struggle with that. Can you talk to us about that a little bit?
Yeah, when I wrote the book, so I'm unique. I'm an ordained pastor, but I'm also a certified financial planner. And my mom was a second grade school teacher. And so she kind of instilled in me this whole idea of quest stories. So in the book, I use lots of different stories. And one of the ones that I use is about the Wizard of Oz and talking about how God kind of shows us the way to handle money, kind of like the Yellow Brick Road does. But, you know, one of the areas I speak 40 weekends a year in different churches, and one of the big things that I'm always trying to help people to do is to realize that you've got to get to where you have that emergency savings fund. Whether you're a business owner, whether you're a family, because too many people, they're exactly what Mitch said, they're always running with no margin. And that's just a really dangerous place to be if you don't ever have any savings at all.
Right. And then in your adventure tale, what's great about this is he takes a lot of different movies and books and things and makes it kind of fun reading, because reading about finances to me would be quite boring.
My wife said she would never read a finance book, but she actually said she enjoyed this because I used all the stories.
And that was your wife too, exactly. So she had. But you know, but you talk about in one of the chapters here, I think the first couple of chapters here, you talk about the dragon. I think it's coming off the Hobbit movie. Can you tell us about the dragon a little bit?
Yeah, so in the Hobbit, if you've seen the movie, there's Smaug the dragon. If you remember when he's talking, he's got this slithery speech and he's trying to bring people in. And that's a lot of the way debt is. And so I'm a little unique. I actually don't think debt is inherently evil. Actually, if you go back in scripture, I can make that case pretty clearly, and I do in the book. But I do think debt is very dangerous. And so I talk about a 3-point test in the book of how do you determine if debt is okay. I don't say it's good. I say it's okay or it's bad. Because there's okay dragons and there's bad dragons. And so the 3-point test, just quickly, is it has to be something where ultimately the item has the ability to go up in value or it's going to produce income. So that's one time you would use debt. A second time, part of the test is you should never borrow more than what the item is worth. And then the third thing is it should not be putting a strain on your budget. And so based upon that test, there's actually 3 things that I think are okay to use debt for. You got to read the book to figure out what those 3 things are. Some of you know what they are, though.
And so what are some of your tips on how to maximize our giving to become more generous?
Yeah, so, you know, Jesus says to give to Caesar what is Caesar's. And I am a big believer that we should pay our legitimate taxes, but I also think we as Christians need to be shrewd and not pay more than we need to pay. And so I'll give you 2 quick things. For some people in here, I'm going to give you something that's going to save you thousands of dollars. There's a quote I use and I share all around as I travel to churches each weekend. It's friends don't let friends give cash unless that's all they have. And so for some of you, you're giving out of your checking account to your church or to different charities, and the reality is that is not the right way for you to give. The best way for you to give is to give appreciated stock. So let's say you had bought some stock down here years ago. That stock, let's say, is now up here today. You should not be giving out of your checking account. You should be giving that stock into a giving fund. You never have to pay the capital gains on all that money that you made over the years. You get the maximum tax write-off. And so that's an amazing way to do your giving. And then you can still take your money in your checking account, go back and buy that stock if you want to. The second thing is, for some of you, you used to get a charitable contribution every year when you did your giving. But the reality is, with the change that happened in 2018 to the tax code, you no longer get to do that, because some of you may know the standard deduction went from $12,700 to this year it's $25,900. And so you should do what we call bunching, where you take 2 years of giving, dump it into a giving fund, and then give it away to charities over the course of 2 years. That way, every other year, you're getting a tax reduction. So that's a great way for some families to save some money on taxes. And my hope is that means they'll give more money away to ministry and more lives will be changed.
Great. And then, so you referenced The Wizard of Oz, you referenced The Hobbit, and then probably one of my all-time favorite movies is Star Wars, and you referenced Yoda in leaving a legacy. Can you talk to us about leaving a legacy?
Yeah, so I have taught a bunch of small groups this 5-chapter book. And one of the questions I ask when I finish the legacy chapters, and I'd love for you to think through this yourself. What grade would you give your parents on how they taught you to handle money from God's perspective? I have taken a lot of people through this. I will tell you the two most common grades are D and F. Now, what's interesting, now, and a lot of the people I've taught are people that have a tendency toward this, but when I've asked families now how they think they're teaching their kids, the most common grade I get today is B. So that, I think it's part of it. There's more resources out there than there used to be. And I also think some of it is, it's a little, not quite as taboo to talk about money. But so that's encouraging for me to see that. So one thing I think is obviously teaching kids. The other area is helping people think through their legacy. And so one of the things our ministry does is we help people in our churches, and we do it for free, where you can get a no-cost will or trust done as long as you're going to leave money to ministry when you pass away. Because I want people thinking about what's going to make a difference 1,000 years from now. And that's one of the ways you can do that is a legacy plan rather than paying, you know, an attorney a lot of money to do that.
So the way this worked, the way CFR, Christian Financial Resources, the way it worked was about 42 years ago. A group of pastors and a group of business leaders, they got together and said, like, we've got all these Christian churches, and we should be pulling our resources together and helping people in the church individually to have the greatest rates of return, and then helping churches to be able to fund ministry and fuel ministry through loans, through remodel projects, through building projects, and do it at the lowest interest rates possible. Plus, the money that you invest in CFR goes out to planting new churches. And that's why it's been one of the most strategic partnerships to have. And it was born out of the vision and hearts of Christ followers who are pastors and business leaders 42 years ago. So tell us a little bit about CFR, how that can benefit us as a church and then as individuals.
Yeah, I get asked, did you start CFR? No, I was 8 years old when it got started. So needless to say, I did not start the ministry at CFR, but I love this ministry. I've been doing it 25 years. It's my passion, my calling in life. Our ministry has now funded over $1 billion of church loans. On a typical weekend, over 300,000 people are attending churches that we have financed. So I love that. I love that I get to help people on their stewardship journey to try to find ways to manage their resources in a way that honors God. And so we do that through our savings. People can park their savings with us and get anywhere from 1% to 2.8%. They can move over IRAs to our ministry. They get to know all those ways that's being used to help churches. And then we help people save money on taxes through that giving fund so they get the maximum tax deduction that they can, but they also get to know that they're funding awesome churches around the country. So, yeah, if you want to get more information, I told Mitch that what I would do is everybody here, I'm going to give a free copy of the book if you're willing to fill out a response card. Save you $10 on Amazon. Hopefully you enjoy it. It's been fun for me. I'm getting all these calls and emails and texts from across the country, having thousands of these out now. So it's been a lot of fun.
Well, I asked him last night. We were having dinner, and I asked him last night, I said, how can we buy your book for the church? And he says, I didn't write this book to make money off of it. I wrote this for the churches and so that people would be able to, you know, have a great resource and a great tool. So I thought that was pretty cool. But I know last service, he said, this was the greatest response of any church that you've had, he said, in a long, long time and years. And so Darren's going to be out in the foyer after the services today if you want more information. He's just honest, trustworthy man of great, great integrity. I trust him with my life, and I trust him with my wife. You know, that's how I always say. And so I love this guy. He's been a great partner in ministry. Darren, would you pray for us? Can you guys stand? And Darren, would you pray over our church and how God has been blessing us and ways that we can partner with you guys?
Let's do it. Heavenly Father, I just praise you, Father, that you are the creator of all things. And Father, we confess to you that there are times that we forget that fact and that we begin to worship the created things. But Lord, I'm so thankful, as Mitch talked about today in the message, that Lord, you've blessed us so much just in this country that we live in, the resources that we all have, our time, our talent, and our treasure. And Lord, I would just ask that you would help every one of us to always be looking for ways to use whatever you've entrusted to us to be a part of the most important task in the entire universe, and that's sharing the love of your Son with people that don't know him. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let's worship.
I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah.
See you next week.